All right, so I think we're recording, so welcome to the Water Commissioners meeting tonight, April 10th. Before we begin, I just want to let everyone know that this meeting is being recorded and broadcast live on Facebook Live, and it's, it will be on local cable and is stored there for cable on demand. It doesn't look like there's microphones because they're hidden around in the wall, so that does apply to the audience, so just know that it will pick up everything, even a whisper. And with that, we're going to go right into, well, first, let me introduce the members of the board. Jen, do you want to start?
Yes, Jennifer Stacey.
Mark Lamb.
I'm Dottie Fulgenetti.
And I'm Craig Barger.
And then we have our Town Administrator Connor Reed, Assistant Town Administrator Michael Blanchard, and Executive Assistant Elizabeth Hay. So we'll go right into this. For item one is a discussion and vote for a declaration of state of water supply conservation, phase three. And we have Rich Tammy, the Water Division Operations Manager, and David Field, DPW Director of Water.
Good evening. Thank you all for taking up a subject matter that's near and dear in my heart. So water restrictions this time of year always play in a big role as to trying to stay within our Water Management Act permit. So there's two usual numbers that reflect after the year. The RGPC, which is the residential gallons per use per person today. Each one of those numbers, usually we look to try to get that to 65 or below. And thankfully, the last couple of years, because we enacted tier three water restrictions, we have managed to bring our number below that 65. So we do have a large amount of water construction projects going on at five of our wells presently. And we also have a significant water main project in that area on Red Mill Road, which also kind of necessitates our advanced, heightened act of looking for tier three water restrictions. So the tier three is 1 day a week for even, 1 day a week for odd, only between the hours of 5 a.m. and 8 a.m. And so those are some of the basic guidelines for the tier three. Last year, I think the number was less than 10 that we actually exceeded 3 million gallons a day during the summer months. So usually 3 million gallons a day is really pushing our water system, pushing the infrastructure. You run the risk of doing damage to the wells. It also has a huge significant electrical cost. So in order to try to prevent undue damage to our resources and with all the construction, I'm asking you all to embrace tier three this year.
Great. Before I take questions, I do want to note that our other select board member, Jamie Stebbins, was on camera and I caught it out of the corner of my eye, but I was already down the path past it. So I do want to acknowledge that he is here by Zoom as he travels. So any questions so far from anyone on the board?
No.
Did this last year as well.
Yeah, pretty standard.
So I think that going out of the gate out of level three is really smart. And there was some differences in years that we started at two and went to three, but especially when we are looking at water preservation. And I know that the Green Communities did some water conservation social media, and we're really promoting that out there. And the question that always comes up is, what about people that have private wells? And I know the answer, but do you want to share that?
Usually, the answer from our regulators, the DEP, is that those private well owners should be following the same bylaws that we have for water restrictions.
Okay. But we can't hold them to it with regards to penalties because it's not part of the public infrastructure, or do they get penalties also if they're watering outside of the restrictions?
No, we just try to, you know, embrace or enforce that kind of following our same water restrictions so that it doesn't create that. But as you know, it's a hard thing to try to enforce on somebody who's paid for that piece of infrastructure on the property.
Okay, I think it really is important, especially in the summer months, and especially when we're building new water infrastructure, to be able to take it easy on some of that water relief during the summer. Particularly, we've had very extreme droughts over the past few years, and when we have a lot of rain, it looks like, well, we must have tons of water because it's rained a lot, but it doesn't absorb into the infrastructure the same way when we have large rainstorms at once, right?
Yeah, so we don't ever know what is our fate each year, and sometimes we've had really wet Julys, and conversely, like last year, it was, you know, hot weather all season long, and there was lots of enforcement by the state for the drought task force, and we're going to see more and more of that, you know, playing out, where the drought task force asks us to increase the levels if we have lower levels to start from, and then it's always trying to catch up with the communication with the public.
Right. So it always comes up with people saying, well, I see watering on the wrong days and the wrong hours, and what do they do when that happens?
So last year we had a lot of calls. So it's hard for me, but what I've kind of asked my staff is, you know, when we're out there looking for violators, nothing replaces a picture or photograph that's indisputable. So that's where I try to go. We'll take the information that a resident gives us, but without a picture, without some showing of a sprinkler system running on the wrong day, it's hard for me to kind of enforce those things. So pictures are indisputable in my world.
Okay, that's a point well taken. Thank you for that, Richard.
And the first time you get a warning, and I say this every year that we have this meeting, is that I got the big sticker on my front door one year when my husband didn't set the sprinklers up at the right time, so throw him under the bus. But I know that whoever the house is, doesn't matter who they are or what they live in, so we're asking everybody to just pitch in. Excellent. Well, if there's no other questions, then I'll make a motion for it.
Sure. A motion to declare a Phase 3 state of water supply conservation from May 1, 2023 to November 1, 2023.
Second, Lamb.
Roger and Lamb, all in favor? Jamie? Okay, that's unanimous. The next item that we have is the minutes, the acceptance of the minutes dated December 19, 2022.
Second that motion.
Lamb and Barger, all in favor? Jay? Unanimous. Excellent. All right, and with that, we'll take a motion to adjourn this meeting.
So moved.
Did we miss anything?
No.
Okay, so that's Barger and Lamb. All in favor to adjourn? Unanimous. Excellent.
Great. Thank
all
you,
right. Thank you, Rich and David.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Now we'll go into our regular meeting. So welcome to the Select Board meeting of April 10th. Please join me in the pledge of
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So I'll make another mention for our people that are just tuning into this meeting that this meeting is being recorded, live streamed on Facebook and local cable, and available on demand. We have a full board here tonight. We have Jamie Stebbins on Zoom, Jennifer, Stacy, brain block there, Mark Lamb, Craig Barger, I'm Dottie Fulgenetti. We have Connor Reed, our town administrator, Michael Blanchard, assistant town administrator, and Elizabeth Hegg, executive assistant. Connor, am I missing something?
All votes have to be by roll call if there's a hybrid participant.
Oh, okay.
Okay,
I didn't realize that. Okay. All right, so the first item that we have here is the Arbor Day Proclamation. Craig, do you want to read that?
Sure. Arbor Day Proclamation 2023. Whereas the legislators of the Great and General Court, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, have adopted an act regarding the designation of Arbor Day throughout the Commonwealth. And whereas the purpose of the designation of Arbor Day throughout the nation is to encourage the planting of shade and forest trees, to encourage the harvesting of forest crops by approved conservation methods, and to encourage the protection of all forests from the scourge of devastating fires, insects, and disease that destroy the beauty and usefulness of our woodlands as well as their wildlife. And whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, produce oxygen, clean the air, provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas trees increase property values and beautify our community. And whereas trees, whenever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal and provide an enduring heritage to succeeding generations. Now, therefore, we, the Select Board of the Town of Easton, do hereby proclaim Friday, April 28, 2023, as Arbor Day in the Town of Easton, and urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands. And further, we urge all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being of this and future generations. Given under our hand and seal of the Town of Easton this 10th day of April in the year of our Lord, 2023.
Anybody have any comments or questions about the Arbor Day proclamation? All right, Easton is a tree city. I think we've been a tree city for 28 or 29 years.
Higher than that, yeah.
Is it higher than that? So we do care a lot about Arbor Day. And if somebody would like to make a motion to accept the proclamation.
So moved, Bodger.
Second, Lim.
Bodger and Lim, we'll do a roll call vote.
Stacy, yes.
Lim, yes.
Fulgenetti, yes.
Bodger, yes.
Evans, yes.
Terrific, that's unanimous. Thank you. Next up, we have a public hearing for a poll petition.
Select Board of Easton is licensing authority pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 166, Section 22, will hold a public hearing in the Colina A. Corona Boardroom, 136 Elm Street, Easton, Mass., on Monday, April 10, 2023, at 6:05 p.m. to consider an act on a petition of the Massachusetts Electric Company, doing business as National Grid and Verizon New England, Incorporated, to install one JO pole on Lincoln Street, beginning at a point approximately 110 feet east of the center line of the intersection of Lincoln Street and Old Stable Lane, installing new pole 17-50 roadside to serve new home 9 Reardon Way, in accordance with the petition for plan number 3056-2795, dated March 24, 2023, as shown on file with the Select Board's office.
Good evening, my name is Thomas. I'm here on behalf of National Grid to petition for pole 17-15, as you said, on the corner of Reardon Way and Lincoln Street to serve the new home on 9 Reardon.
Okay. Any questions from anyone on the board?
Not currently.
So this is a brand new pole?
Correct.
Okay.
So we do have someone from the public that had a question. If you want to come up and introduce yourself.
Probably get over there.
Yes, please.
Thank you.
Just introduce yourself and your street address.
Hi, my name is Anne Marie. I live at 88 Lincoln Street.
Your last name also, maybe?
Martini. And I was unaware that this was even happening. I did not get notification. So I was surprised to see that they were doing anything. I don't even know what pole it is. I just got, my neighbor showed me a notification of a notice that she got for a hearing, and I don't know what's, I didn't even know that they were building a house down the street until I saw lot stakes along my property. So I have no idea what's going on, which pole, if they know this one in back, this one in front, so.
So this is your home here?
Yep.
On this side of the Reardon Way here, the only other way to get power down to 9 Reardon was to do substantial tree cutting.
Okay.
To get the required wires down there. So the easiest way is to set a new pole in the street and then just go all underground.
So you're going on my property or 86, you're going on 86?
So there's a right-of-way easement along Reardon Way, and it's going to go between that easement and 86.
All right, so it's not going to affect my property?
No.
So the pole's going to be over there?
Correct.
What's going to happen when you start to jackhammer and dig for the pole? I have a 120-year-old house, and my foundation is rocks. Is it going to shimmy shake and now I'm going to get water? Or what's going to happen with, you're widening, right? So what's going to happen when you wider? Is the water table going to change? Is under earth going to, I don't know. This is all new to me, but I don't want, you know, my house sits lower than Reardon Way.
The only thing National Grid is doing is setting the pole. Everything else is private. That's going to be on the developer.
Okay, so when you set the pole, jackhammering?
I believe they co-bore. They just drill out a hole.
Okay.
And then they use it.
Is that going to affect my property by shaking, shimmering, or anything underground? Because they fixed the pole over here when somebody hit it. And that shook my whole house. And now I have windows that don't open properly when they did when I first moved in.
Yeah, when they pull these, when they drill for the poles, they just use a giant auger. It doesn't shake. Or
okay, because this one's supported by another one, so they were jackhammering. I was home when it happened.
Yeah, I'm not sure why they would have done that.
Yeah, they were outside for quite some time, and that's how I know I had a home inspection. My windows closed. Now they don't close on that side. So I can't open and shut them. I have to get that taken care of somehow. So that was my concern with you putting a pole. What's going to happen, you know, with that side of my house now?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
My question here, if you have one other, just introduce yourself and your
family. I'm Carla Ramsey. I live at 2 Reardon Way. And I was also hoping to see where the pole was.
Sure. So you would be.
Right here.
Right here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you're coming out, it'll be on the right side.
Right here at this dot?
Yeah.
Okay. So are the wires going to be underground?
They are.
They are going to be underground. So this is the concern that I have. So this was not approved. Reardon Way is a private way. It's not maintained by the town. It's not plowed by the town. It's not paved by the town. It's not maintained by the town. So my issue here is that you're putting in a pole and you want to now come down under the street. And this was never approved. I went to Stephanie Danielson. In regards to this, she was unable to give me any information. She told me there was a behind closed door that approved for Reardon Way to be widened. So this pole, again, is just a whole insult as to what's going on in Reardon Way.
To be clear, the pole's going in Lincoln Street in the existing right of way for Lincoln Street. Yes.
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But Reardon Way is a private way, and to get those wires down, they're going to have to rip up Reardon Way to do so. And that's not something that we're in agreement of. We spent $7,500 and paid that recently on our off.
And what do you say we are?
The neighbors.
Okay.
The neighbors.
And is that something that you and the folks who own 9 Reardon Way have been working on, or?
So 9 Reardon Way hasn't approached us at all. I have the plans that were approved originally,
mm-hmm.
and they did not include widening Reardon Way. And there has been no notice in regards to widening Reardon Way. There's been just talk from the builder that they're just going to go ahead and do that. Next thing you know, we have all purple or pink lines all throughout our street, stakes all over, and no one's notified us of this. The captain originally for the fire department had said that it would be fine as is. And something changed along the way, and they've decided they're going to rip it up. And they've not notified or had agreement from any of the residents on Reardon Way to date.
And just to be specific, when you say that, you mean the owners of 9 Reardon?
Correct.
Okay.
They have not yet, the builders.
Okay. So we can follow up with you on that. I just want to make sure that the road, and I don't have personal knowledge of that, so I will check with planning, but the road widening is not directly related to the wire, correct? Okay.
But to get down there, you have to affect Reardon Way to get down there?
That again, that's on the developer.
Okay, so you're just going to put a pole in Lincoln?
Correct.
You're not going to run any wires?
You're going to have a service
terminate
there. The
install pipe is on the contractor of building the house, so as far as the pipe going to the ground.
So that wasn't approved, that's what I'm saying. That pipe was not approved by the owners of Reardon Way.
But to be clear, that's not something the select board would approve
mm-hmm.
at all under any circumstances. It's not the body that would be involved.
Yeah, no, I do understand what you're
okay.
saying. Yeah.
But
so.
For my own clarification, Andrew, you're installing a pole and you're dropping a service there, but you're not actually proceeding down the rear.
No, well, that is an overhead.
Okay.
No, as far as, so once the approved pipe is in the ground,
then you would run the
then
run
you can pull wire through, right.
And
as far as putting the
pipe in the ground.
Yeah.
Who approved the pipe?
That's on the builder.
Yeah,
it was. Not on us.
Okay. What was your name again?
Carla Ramsey. I sent to the commissioner's office as well, and I dropped off a letter here as well to notify the situation that's been going on.
Okay. And you're 2 Reardon?
I am, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I have a couple statements. I'm her husband, Derek Ramsey. So I guess my question is, widening the road was for emergency vehicles so they could access in any emergency. Yeah, you're gonna have football poles basically on both corners.
No,
Oh, sorry, can I,
yeah, clarify, through the chair, please, and then if the chair would like to mark you to wait, then put that after David.
Two big pictures here, so at least we have football. So my question is, have you considered, if you're widening the road, and it's so important to widen the road, how you plan on getting a fire truck around these poles in an emergency? Is, there's no way you're making that turn unless they're 20 feet apart.
This is true.
So it's kind of like hypocrisy, if you kind of think about it, you know, like, oh, we need a pole. Oh, we need to widen the road. You're destroying an ancient rock wall. You're taking away 100-year-old oak trees and doing all this. So, I mean, yeah, there has to be some compassion for the owners of Ridden Way when you don't help us plow. You don't help us fill potholes. You don't help us, you know? So we take care of it. We're fine with that. But now when it's time to sell some land, make some money, I don't know, it's like you can just come right on in and do what you want. We have not got that letter that we got for today. It was the first communication we got from the townies. Not about selling the land, not about right of ways, not about electric poles, not about widening the road, not about taking down oak trees, nothing. You guys have not spoken to us at all. And I know that's against the law.
Selling what land?
Accessing Ridden Way to sell that number nine Ridden Way.
Was it owned by the town?
No, it was owned by...
So because we would not notify you, the town?
No, but it had to go through permitting. There was wetlands and vernal pools, and we had a hearing 18 months ago about it.
So that's not before this board, so we wouldn't notify anybody about it. It doesn't come...
All right, so you're not going to notify us about anything?
No, because it doesn't come before this board. Why would we notify? We don't even get notified about it.
Can you talk to your colleagues and constituents about notifying us in the future?
They'll do what they have to do by the state of the law. That's not what we're here for. We're here to talk about the poll petition, so...
All right, so the poll petition seems odd. You're going to get a fire truck around that in an emergency where you need a lot of work.
That's true. There's a hybrid there right now.
And the question for you,
Chief, to...
Does the wires go straight down the pole?
Excuse me.
Sure.
I'd like to ask the chief, have we looked at that for a fire truck getting down there, or is that something we need to explore?
So, thank you. The pole placement, I have not seen, so I'd like to see that to provide a comment, but generally I can speak to the road itself if you'd like.
Sure.
when we took a look at that plan, that was, because I had to go through the permitting process, the feedback we provided the planning department on that was that if a house would go in there, that we would need a wider access to get a truck down in there. It's more important that we can get in, we can take our time getting out, because obviously getting out would be difficult because we'd have to back down. There's no way to turn around, even with a wider road. But it's more important that we can get in, which the way it is now, getting in there is extremely difficult, especially if you're even further back. So our feedback for the planning purposes was to request that the road be widened if a house was going to go there. If it wasn't, then the road stays the way it is. Subsequently, apparently, the house was approved, and that was a requirement under that permit. So as far as that goes, that's how that process came to be with my car. As far as the pole placement, I like to take a look at that, because sometimes when a pole is in the way for access from one direction versus another, if it's on one corner, we have a pre-plan that we would come in a different direction so that we don't have to deal with the pole. But that's something we would have to plan. Usually we can work around that when we have a pole right on the corner. You would just know that you got to come in, whether it's from the Bay Road side or you got to come in from down the uptown side.
Right.
But you got one on that side right there too.
Yeah, we'd have to take a look at that for our planning purposes.
And the hybrid too. It's right there as well.
Yes.
Which is hard for my Subaru Ascent to get.
So, Carter, is this something that we should table, or how do you recommend that we handle this?
Well, the only question for the board is regarding the approval of the pole placement on Lincoln Street. If the board wants to condition it on the fire department reviewing its location relative to the WIF to ensure that there's no concerns with fitting apparatus, you could do so. And if the chief for some reason feels that that's not doable, it would have to come back.
Okay. Are you comfortable with that?
I am. We've dealt with this many times as far as pole placement, and moving it, you know, 5 feet one way can make a difference over another, and we can work through that for access purposes.
All right. Any questions or comments from anyone on board?
Those pole placement.
All right. Let's take a motion.
Can I say something else?
Sure.
The other pole
come
is.
Can you please?
The wires are going straight down the across the sidewalk.
So the other pole is on the corner in front of my house. So if you're going to do something with that one, how does that affect this one?
And if you, is that gonna cut, now if you're gonna widen the road, is that gonna take, that's gonna cut some of my property. And my house sits lower on Reardon than it does on Lincoln. So Reardon's here and my house is down here. So that's, you know, a big concern for me on when you're doing stuff, if you're gonna landfill it, or what's gonna happen with that. And if you do approve a pole and it goes underneath, what's gonna happen underneath? As you're going down on both sides, if you have to widen it to get wires underneath.
So that's not really in front of this board. This board is really just approving the location for the pole.
Okay. Well, just so you're aware, there's another one. Thanks.
All right, Kurt, do you want to make a motion contingent on the fire chief reviewing and
approving? So moved, Barger.
Second, Lynn.
That's Barger and Lynn, and it's a roll call vote. Start with you, Jeff.
Stacy, yes.
Lynn, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Evans, yes.
Thank you. All right, thanks everyone for being here. We appreciate your input.
Thank you.
Next up, we have some licenses and permits. One day liquor license. So the first one is the one day liquor license for Stonehill College for the Equestrian Team Banquet at 320 Washington Street. It's April 29th from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. And this week's detail is not required. Any comments or questions from the board? Make a motion.
Move to have permit to Stonehill College Equestrian Team Banquet, 320 Washington Street, April 29th, 2023, from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m.
Second, Lynn.
So that's Barger and Lynn. All in favor, roll call vote.
Stacy, yes.
Lynn, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Yes, yes.
Terrific. Next, we have Labe Venue, Private First Communion at 574 Washington Street, May 7th, 2023, 7 p.m. to 12 a.m. They have applied for this one-day beer and wine license for a private event, and an Easton police detail is not required.
I move to approve a Labe Venue, Private First Communion, 574 Washington Street, May 7, 2023, 7 p.m. to midnight.
Second, Lynn.
So that's Barger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Lynn, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Yes, yes.
Great. All right, next we have some appointments. The Public Spaces Committee. We have Thomas Lowell. Is Thomas here? No. So this is an uncontested, which I am. Uncontested, the Public Spaces Committee. Where is it? I'm sorry. Mr. Lowald has degrees in economics and management and has been as collaborative, thoughtful, and willing to serve. So this is the only applicant that we have for this. And unless anybody objects, I would take a motion to appoint Mr. Lowald to the Public Spaces Committee.
So moved, Barger.
Second, Lamb.
Barger and Lamb.
Stacy Lowald.
Lynn Lowald.
Full Genetti Lowald.
Barger Lowald.
Stevens Lowald.
Next, we have discussion and vote for waste management, curbside waste and recycling contract extension, fiscal 24 to 26.
Sure, thank you, Dottie. So items 5 and 6 are related to each other. We just had to pick one to go first. So the first item is an extension of the existing curbside waste and recycling pickup contract that the town has originally entered into in 2007 with waste management. This would be the fifth amendment. What we are proposing is a 3-year amendment starting this July through the end of fiscal 26, which would be June 30th of 2026. In your packet, you had a kind of term summary update from waste management that outlined any kind of changes here. For the secondary item, because these things are intrinsically linked, it's an enterprise funded account. Basically, it's funded through fees rather than through general taxation. Anytime we negotiate an extension with waste management, we, through my office, Public Works, and most of all, the finance department, they run an accounting assessment of what those rate structures would do to the rate that this board sets. We have tried to minimize any rate increases to the extent possible over the years. The last time we did was 2.5 years ago. Like almost any other market, there's been some major impacts in waste collection. Recycling is really volatile, and so As part of this, we are recommending the board consider an increase from 90 to 100 per quarter and a right sizing of extra barrels, which were basically half of a quarterly fee set, as far as we could tell, back in 2007 and not adjusted over time. And so we want to make sure that that more appropriately reflects adding 50% more trash or recycling from the town. So your packet, again, has a kind of broad overview summary from Waste Management. We have representatives from Waste Management here tonight to answer any questions the board has about the proposal, what that means for service in Easton, as well as the Finance Director and Director of Public Works for any questions about the financial impact or the operational impact for our departments. Finally, just as a note, the formal extension was provided to you earlier today. You have a hard copy in front of you. There's still drafting going back and forth between our council and Waste Management's council on one paragraph. So if the board is inclined to approve, it would just be conditioned on final approval from town council, which I would recommend, provided there's no objections. But happy to, you know, who you would like to come up first. We have a lot of folks here.
Would you like to come up?
Sure.
I'm Jim Nassal, Waste Management and Public Sector Services.
Thank you.
And I'm Heather Laurel, Waste Management and Public Sector Services.
We're glad you're here tonight.
Thank you.
Waste Management has been a good partner to the community for quite a while now. And in particular, some of your drivers get lots of shout outs on social media that the neighbors come to really have a great bond with them. So
thank you.
We appreciate that service. Any comments or questions from anyone on the board about the details of what's being offered?
Are there any changes aside from the $90 to $100?
Just one small change to try to improve services in a particular section. So we're just going to move some houses from one day to another just to balance out the routes, the growth of the program, the popularity of the program. It's grown over the years, and so now we've got certain route days that are getting just a bit too long. So we're going to just move, and we'll notify all the homes of that. But beyond that, everything else is fairly business as usual. The other thing might be that with the bulk item collection program, we're going to ask folks to register for when there's the full collection townwide. And that will allow us to really know where everything is and be able to provide, hopefully, a higher level of service when it comes to that. So those are really the two, I think, significant.
And Jim, to be specific, correct me if I'm wrong, on the folks who are getting moved to a different day, that would be moving them up from Friday to Thursday, you think?
No, there's about 400 homes affected.
Yes.
And I have a list of streets, and they're on various days through the week. A couple homes on Monday are going to be moved to Thursday. It's just routing.
Okay.
But they're all going to be moved to Thursday. I'll send you the list, and then everything's going to be...
Yeah. And there's going to be a provision of functionally an additional half truck, is that about right?
Yeah, we're putting in a full route on Thursday, an
okay.
additional route, so it's going to be split in half recycling and half trash,
okay.
yeah, half rubbish.
Because one of the things we worked on with Public Works and negotiating this was making sure that we try to minimize, you know, missed pickups, super equipment failures, and things of that nature, so having the additional trucks towards the end of the week could help stop some of that from slipping in the weekend. As far as the bulk item, that's one where, you know, we are hesitant to change how these things work, but not everyone puts something out, and so depending on the street you're on, if you're on a smaller street in particular, if the driver doesn't see something out immediately, it's easier to miss. So we're hopeful that by doing the pre-registration, which I think at first will be just from a toll-free number, eventually perhaps online, for no cost, that they will have better data on where these items actually are so that there's fewer misses and less time spent overall going back. Because for our concern, frequently what folks will do is call Public Works if that happens. And so it ends up kind of tying up and bottlenecking at DPW.
I think that's a good idea though, because it seems like it would be more efficient for everybody and the less trucks we have to have on the roads.
Right.
Easton is a really big town, as the snowplow drivers probably will tell you, right? If you have to go up and down every road in the town, that seems kind of wasteful and not great for the environment. So I think that was a great idea. What about the recycling and curbside recycling? So just as a reminder, there's, you know, you don't take mattresses, you don't take household textiles. The Green Communities, again, they promoted how to recycle best practices, and even myself, you know, people are still stumped with what can you put in the recycling, what can you not, you know, to rinse stuff out so that there's no food in it. We used to think you couldn't put pizza boxes in, but now you can as long as there's no food attached to it, you know. So will you be doing any kind of campaigns that we could share through social media about the details of that?
Yeah, so we typically will do an annual flyer to everybody that kind of gives the outline of what's acceptable, what's not acceptable. That will happen. And with that, there's some links that are actually on the town website as well. We'll call both. There's a couple of places where you can go to really get a pretty good, clear idea of what's acceptable and what isn't. And one of them is a collaboration with the state, recyclesmart.org. That really has a great recyclopedia, so you can go in and put in an item and it'll say, hey, that's generally acceptable in a curbside recycling program. So no bowling balls, pizza boxes are good, but no pizza. And then, yeah, it's really just, we always say, you know, dry, no liquids, no food. And then, you know, just work from the list of common acceptable recyclables. And by the way, we do audit and check every community's recyclables that come into our facility, and Easton has a, you know, has a good track record of doing a good job, so we'll continue to promote that.
That has to do with the contamination levels, which you might want to talk to so folks at home can understand what happens with that issue of contamination.
Yeah, I mean, contamination is, you know, certainly became very, very prevalent about 4 or 5 years ago. It's always been an issue, but it became very prevalent 4 or 5 years ago when markets changed and got much stricter on what they would accept. And so when there is a lot of, we'll call it non-recyclable materials in a recycling container, it becomes very problematic for the facility that's cleaning that and separating that and baling that into its different, you know, commodities, if you will. And it can be expensive. It can be expensive because you have to pull all of that material out. It then has to be disposed of as solid waste as opposed to recyclables. And even the community could, you know, ultimately pay a fee if there was a really high level of contamination. And that's why it's, you know, it's really important that this town has done a great job at, you know, kind of communicating out and keeping that, you know, under control. But it's something that we have to be vigilant about.
Well, I think something that we talked about a lot and when that first came up was the plastic bags that you get, the plastic grocery bags get caught in the gears when they go through single stream recycling. So hopefully, I'll just take the opportunity to say it again in case people are watching. Don't put those plastic grocery bags in your recycling. I try to use my reusable bags every once in a while. Forget, I end up with some of those plastic bags, and you can recycle those by bringing them back to the grocery stores. They have bins there that you can get rid of all of those. So, and then with textile recycling, we do have bins at the schools, and they collect money for that. So, they take, you know, shoes, sneakers, sheets, towels, any kind of textiles, clothes, whatever, that you put in those bins. So I use that quite often myself, and it's very helpful. So just a reminder for people not to put that in their household trash. All right. Any other questions, comments?
Yeah, I just wanted to wrangle back to the bulk pickup. So this, I love the free registration, by the way. It's fantastic. And over time, I think it'll really have a big impact. But in that kind of learning and getting folks used to phase, like, if someone put something out and didn't pre-register, will it get picked up as trucks drive by, or kind of what will be the transition of like that?
Great question. Yeah, so our thing is to, you know, we'll continue to collect everything. So when a driver is out there doing the sweep collection for the bulk, you know, as they're going along, they're going to collect the materials that are out, even if it wasn't, you know, called in.
Yeah.
And so what will happen is if it happens to be, you know, a small street, and if nobody registered on that small street and the truck doesn't go down, at least we will know and then we'll be able to provide that feedback to the resident about how they can register in the future. But for, you know, coming out of the blocks, we will we'll still continue to go around and collect everything that's out there.
Will you use like a sticker system or reach out to them directly, or how will that look?
No, we would have to work through the town, because you have the communication, you have the resident's name, address, phone number.
Yeah.
And so a lot of times when we run into issues that we collaborate and then we can get a notice out to the folks.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Jamie, any questions?
I just want to thank Waste Management. They hosted our Green Communities Committee at one of the recycling facilities and really walked through. So a lot of the best practices that we're putting together come stem directly from that meeting. So we appreciate that. There's a lot of good that'll come of the education that we reap from that.
Thanks, Jamie. And I think it will just take this opportunity just to say to people that anytime you cannot use single purpose plastic, avoid plastic water bottles. If you can change your laundry detergent to something that isn't a big plastic jug, every little bit helps for the environment, and those things are hard to get rid of. So I know that a lot of people that really do that and have been really trying to switch to more reusable vessels for things, and it really does make a big difference. So. All right, Craig, if you'd like to make a motion.
So we're doing, the first one is the contract extension based upon one item that needs to be.
Yes, so our request of the board is willing a contingent approval of this contract amendment pending final language resolution with town council.
So moved, Bodger.
Second, Lamb.
Bodger and Lamb?
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Bodger, yes.
Evans, yes.
Yes.
Okay, and then the next vote will be for the rate change.
Sure, so attached to your packet, there's a cover memo from Finance Director Wendy Nightingale, just giving a background of the program and its history. Again, as I noted, we've tried to spread out rate increases as much as possible as the market has changed. It has been 2.5 years since the last one. During that time, both the producer price index and consumer price index have grown by more than what this proposed increase is. Although, again, we don't do it until we absolutely have to. Finance Department feels that moving from 90 to 100 would be sufficient to get us through the first year. We can't make promises about multi-year, but we feel comfortable about between that and right-sizing the extra carts. That's a very small number of folks. You have a few hundred extra trash carts in town and less than 100 extra recycling carts. Making sure that those are paying their proportional rate. That plus the surplus we carry should hopefully put us in a good position without having to raise rates too much at once. So Wendy's here if there's any questions about the analysis that's in your packet. Dave's here if there's any questions about the operational impact.
So this would be a raise for first year, and then we come back to talk about the second year, or how do you want to do that?
We would come back when we have to. So part of our just ongoing budget management is that we look at the performance of these enterprise accounts every year as part of our budgeting process. And so if during the normal budget building process that starts in the fall preceding a coming July, Wendy or Dave have data either on subscribership numbers or on the revenue coming in that would lead us to think that the rate's not going to cut it, we would come back to the board with an analysis showing the expected shortfall and recommendation.
Okay, so the proposed increase is from $90 to $100 per quarter.
Correct.
So moved, Roger.
Second, Lynn.
Bodger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Bodger, yes.
Evans, yes.
Great, thank you.
I would just ask for a second vote on that relating to the optional extra carts. Right now, those are at $22.50. Those have not been increased proportionally with the program. And so we're recommending that additional extra carts be set at $50 per extra.
As opposed to $22.50?
As opposed to $22.50. So we think that that is quite a jump, but we think that over time, as we adjusted the base program fee, which is what 4,000-ish customers pay, we didn't tie the extra cards to that as a kind of function. And so it's just gone, as far as we can tell, 10 plus years of being increased.
Right. The collection cost alone is $27
right, so
quarter.
Per unit per quarter. So right now, the base program users would be subsidizing the heavy users if we didn't right size it.
So I move to increase the extra trash and recycling barrels from $25 to $50.
Second.
From $22.50.
I'm sorry, $22.50 to $50.
So that's Bodger and Lamb.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Janetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Stevens, yes.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you so much.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Chief, could you grab one by the door, please? Okay.
So, next we have a discussion and vote on contract PCD 2023-7 for SWCA Inc. Historic Resources Survey and Inventory.
Sure, so I believe he's coming now, but in your packet, in each of them, there's a cover letter from community planner Wayne Beidler and a contract with SWCA Incorporated for Survey Services. The Historical Commission, from time to time, contracts with surveyors for historic property inventory work, and this would be another round of this.
When is the one upstairs?
Oh, okay. This current phase would be for surveying approximately 60 potential historic properties, documenting significant 17th and 18th century headstones and four cemeteries. Annual town meeting approved in 2018 approved $30,000 of CPA funding for this project. The team which did the previous surveys has retired. Very few consultants have been available for this work. Several unsuccessful rounds of requesting qualifications on both sides of the pandemic delayed finding a responsive bidder until now, which is why you have it before you tonight.
Okay. Any comments or questions? Should we wait for Wayne if anyone has any? Or?
I do have some questions. I mean, I'm supportive of the general questions.
Yep, he should be here.
Okay.
I apologize for the delay.
I thought I saw him outside.
He was
outside.
I would have skipped over.
His department is Citizens Academy tonight. He may have, because we always have someone double booked. Let's see what I can fill in, Mark.
Okay. Again, no worries. I'm supportive of this. I'm curious about the documentation. What is included in the document? And if we're documenting this now, what do we have that exists?
So I can answer that. So if you look at the MAPRIS database, MACRIS,
mm-hmm.
you'll see, so I know I've looked at it for my house. You get a whole history of who lived in your house, what did they do?
These are for headstones.
Oh, for headstones.
They do have a decently specific scope in here. Let me just try and find. So you're specific to the headstones, okay. Phase three entails the documentation of a limited number of significant 17th and 18th century headstones in Easton's historic cemeteries. The consultant will update the cemetery inventories in accordance with the Massachusetts Historical Commission Form E burial ground involving preliminary research, fieldwork, and photography of each headstone. They'll then produce burial ground forms from four cemeteries. Historical narratives will focus on 17th and 18th century burials. They will consult with Easton historians to incorporate their research into four inventory forms. The Easton Cemetery Commission's cemetery database from March of 2022 identifies 172 headstones existing in Easton before 1800. The consultant will produce inventory forms for four cemeteries, including Easton South Cemetery on 473 Washington Street, Pratt Cemetery at 474 Washington, the Church Street will bury around at 46 Church Street, and the Cynthia Drake Cemetery at 45 Church Street. The consultant will notify the local project coordinator 2 months in advance of a field work component effort to coordinate with volunteers for the cleaning of a number of those significant headstones. Let's see. Predetermined significant headstones limited to 15 per cemetery will be photographed for inclusion in the inventory submission to the Massachusetts Historical Commission. And so the deliverable, again, of that will be the four forms of inventory, inventorying before cemeteries with a focus on the earliest headstones of each.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
No.
Jamie?
No, thank you.
All right, would you like to make a motion, Craig?
Can we move to approve the contract with, what's the name of the group? I'm sorry.
It's an acronym.
SWCA Inc. PCD 2023-07 Historic Resource Survey and Inventory.
In an amount not to exceed $28,600.
Second, Lynn.
Bodger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Janetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Bevins, yes.
All right, next up we have a discussion and vote on contract EFD 2023-03 for Motorola Solutions radios for the fire department. Chief Alexander, welcome.
Good evening. Thank you. We're very fortunate to be in front of you tonight with a proposal to, for our contract to replace our portable radios and 55 portable radios and 10 of our mobile radios. The difference, our portable radios are the ones you see us carrying around. Mobile radios are the ones that go in the actual trucks and mount in there. So that would be replacing technology that's 20 years old, out of date, not able to be replaced and fixed. We're actually taking parts from our old radios that don't work anymore, they might have a good part, and putting that good part in another radio that's broken to keep them going. So it's time, and we really appreciate the support going forward. The purchases for Motorola, the radios are very specific to the fire service. They're not cheap, as you can see, but there's a reason for that. It really revolves around our radios in particular have to be what they call intrinsically safe, which means when you use them, you key up the microphone to talk, there's no sparks, so that we're in a gas environment, a flammable environment, we don't ignite the gas. They also have to be designed to take the heat, being inside a building, and the various tough life that they have with us and the work that we do. So that's why you see the cost of these radios so high. But they're made for what we do, and we expect to get a good life out of them, and I'm here to answer any questions you might have about them.
Any questions?
Just one question about 55 units. I mean, can you just talk, I mean, the 10, I had that question too, but
sure.
You answered that one already. But 55 is for the firefighters to carry?
So we have the firefighters that carry them, and each apparatus has a truck radio assigned to it that can be taken if one person's radio doesn't work. If it fails at a scene, they have another radio they can take out of the truck as a spare.
Okay.
And then we also use those spares when one of the radios has to go up for repair. We could take it from an apparatus and issue it to a firefighter. So they kind of serve a dual role.
Okay.
And it's one of those things that it does happen. Radios do break on fire scenes, unfortunately, and we have that spare, which is great because our accountability is 100% radio based. It tracks when you key up our microphones. It shows up on the screen as SEMREC, our name, what channel we're on, all that information that goes with it.
Chief, I wanted to make that connectivity, and unless I'm misunderstanding, part of this is necessary too, to make sure that we have technological compliance with SEMREC standards as they move forward, because they'll be updating, is it microwave or radio wave technology for receivers in the four towns, and the other communities are also updating their radios in concert, is that right?
Correct. So all four towns in SEMREC are upgrading their radios, which includes the portables, mobiles, and the base stations, if you will. The pieces that receive and transmit to SEMREC, the HEROS basically. Those are all being replaced. SEMREC is doing the base station side, the mounts of the antennas throughout town to hear us. So those are all gonna be, they're all Motorola products and they're all designed to work together in concert and improve our radio system dramatically. I'm very much looking forward to hearing how much better our radio sound this whole thing is built out.
When you're not patching them back together with pieces of other radios, what's the typical lifespan based on like basic wear and tear that you guys put them through?
10 years, maybe stretched to 15 for some of them.
Okay.
But you'll see some time. The ones that get the heaviest use, they'll probably be a 10-year lifespan.
Okay.
If they're on 20.
Say it again, sir?
The current ones are on 20.
They're at 20, yeah.
I can't believe
that's why
that
we're
low.
At that. That's why we're at that problem. You know, Rob Peter to pay Paul to get them on.
Jamie, any comments, questions?
No, thank you very much,
Chief.
So this is funded through town meeting vote, I just had it, 2022 special town meeting approvals. All right, would you like to make a motion for it?
Move to approve the $320,000 for the 55 portable radios and 9 mobile radios for the fire department.
And it's awarding the contract to Motorola Solutions.
Motorola, I'm sorry.
Contract EFD 2023-03.
Second, Lynn.
So that's Barger and Lynn?
Stacy, yes.
Lynn, yes.
Full Janetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Stebbins, yes.
Stebbins, yes.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you, Aubrey. All right. Now we are at Public Works, Commonwealth of Eastern Water Division Capital Projects.
Again, plug in real quick.
I'm sure we're going to have seamless integration.
Let's take a look at it.
All right, good evening. I'm Dave Field, Director of Public Works, Rich Turney, Water Operations Manager again. And we're here to just go through some of the many projects we have right now going on in the water. So I just want to talk quickly about, and the reason we have some change orders and amendments to bring toward you tonight, so we thought it'd be a good opportunity to just give you an overview of where we stand on all these projects. We'll talk about Red Mill Road treatment plant, the PFAS plants, our water main replacement project, the Bay Road storage tank rehabilitation project, and our hydraulic model update. So Red Mill Road, as you may know, it's a 1.69 million gallon water treatment plant that treats water from wells 3, 5, and 7. It's going to be a green sand treatment plant that will remove iron and manganese to improve water quality. This has been in the master plan for many years. Pilot testing and design began in 2019. Bids were actually put out in November of 2021. We had 6 contractors bid on the project. Construction started in February of 2022. And we're scheduled for startup and testing this December. The picture on the right is the original site before we broke ground. You can see that picture now is in March of last year once the site was cleared. The project team consists of Environmental Partners as a designer. Our Ty and Bond is our OPM, or Owner's Project Manager. The contractor is Hart Engineering Corporation. And our applications engineer is Wooded and Curran. They handle all our SCADA integration with our existing SCADA system. The project budget, $2.69 million for design and OPM, $12 million for construction, some other for fiber and applications engineering. And then we have a project contingency of $1.3 million. So we're currently 43% complete. We have an available contingency of 10.6% of our original contract cost. There have been no change orders to date. We have a couple minor change orders pending, but the dollar value is so low, it's under $1,000, that it's not worth to bring forth yet. We likely will have a couple change orders, but right now this project's gone very well. You know, minor hiccups with any type of construction, but in general, this has gone very well. Got some overhead drone shots so you can see how we've progressed from March 22 when the site was cleared. April, where we're just starting the foundation work for the clear wells. Forming the clear wells in June. You know, the clear wells have been formed. We're working on more site grading. Clear wells again. Now we're starting the foundation work for the entire plant. The clear well is what runs, it's basically the basement of the plant. It's where the final water gets contact time before it gets pumped out to the distribution system. And then the foundation is built on top of that. So the foundation is being built here in October. Here the foundation and floor slab are complete in November. And if you're looking just north of that, above that, which is actually to the south, is the backwash basins. There's 2 backwash basins that are rough graded at this time. And then in December, we started putting up the steel metal building. And you can see some siding being clad on that building. Now roof panels going on in February. And as of March, pretty much the envelope was completed. So this is what it looks like last month. That's an interior shot. Some of the vessels are there, but they're not in the right places. They're just being stored temporarily. And you can see the facade of the building. That's actually the left side of that building is going to be the front door where people would go in. So that brings us to our concerns on PFAS. So at the time this plant was designed and permitted, PFAS levels for Mass DEP were required to be under 20 parts per trillion for the 6 PFAS compounds. So we did anticipate that something might happen in the future. Our PFAS levels may change in those wells, or regulations may change. So we did include an area, in this area in the foreground here with those 2 large panels looking at you on the right side of the building. for PFAS treatment or other type of treatment if necessary. So we built it into the plan. We actually built that section of the plant higher so we could fit the vessels inside it. We thought we were kind of future-proofing this building. We didn't realize the future was now, unfortunately. So just last month, EPA proposed regulations that would result in us being in non-compliance with our current levels of PFAS in wells 3, 5, and 7 right now. They're basically taking the levels down to zero, but it's 4 parts per trillion is what's detectable, and plus some other health indexes. But right now, we would be, if and when that regulation does go into effect, we would be in non-compliance again. I should say not again, but we'd be in non-compliance with this because we're currently in compliance with the DEP regulations, but under these proposed regulations, we would not be in compliance. So we're currently recommending $250,000 of capital to begin design and permitting and procurement of PFAS treatment equipment should those regulations come to fruition. And that puts in line to apply for SRF loan funding for some of that construction in those vessels. So does anyone have any questions on Red Mill Road or PFAS interaction with Red Mill Road? I'd be happy to.
If I could just add on to clarify for anyone who's watching at home. So nothing about the state regulations have changed yet, but just in the span of when we started this work in 2019 in earnest from now, the EPA has shifted from having basically a non-enforceable lifetime exposure advisory level of 70 parts per trillion, which none of our wells ever hit, to the state taking a firmer stance and saying we're going to do 6 of the thousands of PFAS out there and aggregate them and say if it's more than 20, you're in violation. So that was 3 out of 7 wells. But the other 4 were either non-detect or single digit on average, so it wasn't an issue. And now the very recently proposed regulation from US EPA is much stricter than Mass DEP. And so we will prepare for that and build that in because what DEP has indicated, and I know Rich will be going to a meeting with them shortly, is that the way that their PFAS, the state DEP's PFAS reg works is that they do regulatory review every handful of years anyway, and that they intend to at least match, or at least that was what they have said, at least match federal standards. So we can have some level of confidence this is likely. There is no money attached to this federal regulation, although the EPA does point to a bipartisan infrastructure law, which is much appreciated. But a lot of that money is coming down through states in funding SRF revolving loan programs, or for certain environmental justice communities, forgivable loans. ESID is not one. So there's no grants to offset this. So this, as we've been doing the whole time, we're going to do the right thing and design it. We're going to build it to the standards that are out there. But this will likely add substantial amounts to treatment, not only here throughout Massachusetts, in the United States, certainly.
Any other comments down with you, Chief Alja?
Is there, I know bringing it down to zero, there's no future state from zero, but you can't go lower than that, but is there potential where if PFAS were to increase in the water, would that cause a need for a future state kind of planning situation?
So the PFAS does vary slightly seasonally. As we test it, we test quarterly, monthly and quarterly, depending on the levels. I don't anticipate, hopefully, PFAS, going up significantly. I think, what we're dealing with is more of the regulations going down, so our PFAS levels remaining in the same area. So in an area where we thought we were okay and didn't need to put in PFAS treatment, we're now looking at that. So it's going to be a significant cost issue.
So it's more about filtering down to zero as opposed to capacity of it being a problem.
Exactly.
Okay.
So just also remember, these are all unregulated contaminants right now under the federal oversight. Only Massachusetts has these particular 6. So this past year, we started UCMR 5, and we tested for 23 new PFAS components, which they may be ones that the EPA will add to future contaminants to this maximum national list.
Okay.
I think an important thing here, as much as we don't like the impact on finances and construction of a kind of regulatory leapfrog, but my assessment will probably be happening in the next 30 years on this. Once these plants are built, we will have treatment plants of one type or another at 6 out of 7 wells in Easton. So that doesn't mean there wouldn't be an incremental cost to swap out different types of treatment media. There's certainly going to be a meaningful impact on operational costs, but we will at least have these structures and treatment buildings in place at all the wells which have detected. To my knowledge, well, 6 is the only one that's been non-detected. That could change if instead of PFAS 6, you're doing PFAS 4000. But at least we will have 6 out of 7 of that structure there. Mm-hmm. Silver lining.
Ideally, once if that capital request is approved and everything goes through, how soon do you think you would begin? And
That's a great question. If I had the crystal ball, we don't know what this regulation in the implementation of this regulation is either at this point. So it's still draft and still have comments. So that it could change. You know, we have to plan for it to not change and to be what they say it's going to be. So we're going to go ahead and get ourselves ready.
Yeah,
just like we did when we tested our wells in 2019, way before, 2018 and 19, before DEP really was on the PFAS and we detected PFAS, we started getting ourselves ready and did PFAS preparedness study, which put us in line to build our PFAS treatment plants. Just unfortunately, we were at the point where the leapfrogging starts because we went with a certain standard and now there may be a new standard. So that's the big issue here. So I don't know, we'll be ready to move and we'll start studying this if we get the capital appropriation, which I assume we will. Town meetings will be the ultimate vote on that. Mm-hmm. And then we'll just have to see where this all shakes up.
Yeah, I think the first hearing is May from the US EPA. So we'll submit written comments to that, but it could be sometimes these rulemaking processes, depending on what level of adjustment they want to make based on feedback, can take months or years.
Yeah. One of the complications is getting the equipment to treat it. So like you'll see in the next slide, when we talk about our PFAS treatment plants, we actually had to go out way ahead of time to get the vessels procured because there's a year wait to get vessels. So especially with a new EPA regulation, that may even go up higher because only a certain amount of people make these giant vessels and everyone's gonna be in line for them, so.
Yeah, and right now, I mean, I think the large majority, I'll go back and confirm this, but last I checked, the majority of states in the U.S. don't have MCLs for PFAS, so they're going to go from a functionally no standard to an incredibly strict one. So it's going to be an incredible amount of demand on the market from a very finite amount of manufacturers, let alone skilled labor building. This will cost hundreds of billions of dollars. That doesn't mean it's not worth doing.
No, but it would be nice if you knew, you know, I think Easton had the vision to look ahead down the road. I remember talking about this before, building extra capacity and space in these buildings for should this happen. So, you know, I'm thinking about places that didn't think like that and build just for what they needed, and now they'll have to go out and kind of start from scratch. So it might also actually be better if you have the end result of what you have to get instead of taking several steps to get there for places that haven't done it. I think
it's a bumblebee. Sorry.
Oh my God.
He's friendly.
He's a very large one. He's had a lot of fun.
I think it's great that this is being addressed, and hopefully some of the lawsuits against some of the agencies that are creating the PFAS will do some good to help mitigate this. And I hope that they're spending time figuring out where they're going to put the filters with all of the PFAS laden filters. Where do those go, and how do they dispose of those?
Yeah. So generally, that's that's generally activated carbon and it's burned off, and that the incineration of that carbon to regenerate it destroys the PFAS compound. So for our carbon plants, which we'll get into, you know, that it's just taken out and changed out, and that gets regenerated and incinerated. So.
You indicated that there is not an opportunity for some loans to cover some of the costs of the
equipment and plant modifications, et cetera?
So there are. So there's some low cost loans available through the SRF process. The SRF process in Massachusetts, you have to get on the intended use plan, usually you have to apply, get in basically over the summer, and then the next year they'll tell you if you are on the plan and then sign the paperwork. We've done several SRF projects. All of our sewer projects were SRF loan projects. We did not go with SRF at the time for the Red Mill Road treatment plant or the PFAS treatment plants because there was, it was basically a cost benefit. The cost of money was very cheap, so the loan cost was basically the same, and the administrative costs associated with going for the SRF, there's a lot more hoops to jump through and approvals to get. So we did not go that way. In hindsight, it would have been great if we had, gone that way because we could have set ourselves up for some potential loan forgiveness, but that's generally been reserved for those environmental justice communities and not us. But yes, we if we go forward with this, we will try to go through the SRF loan process, whether it's successful or not, that's anyone's guess, but my guess is PFAS, you know, would rate us pretty highly in that process, but it's not a magic bullet. It's only a low cost loan. And we still are responsible for the, you know, the full vote on that. So
thank you.
Let me just ask Jamie. Jamie, did you have any comments or questions?
Oh, thank you.
Speak up if I don't call on you.
I will do that. Thanks, Bob.
All right, I'll move on to the PFAS treatment plants. A nice little segue there. So our wells 1, 2, and 4 all had levels that required action under the Mass DEP MCL of 20 parts per trillion for the 6 PFAS compounds. We began the treatment study in 2020. Ultimately, granular activated carbon was recommended to treat PFAS and remove those compounds. We bid the treatment vessels in November of 2021, even though we weren't done with the design of the plants, to get those vessels procured and on order. And then we did the construction of the plants in April of 2022. Construction began in June of 2022 and scheduled for a startup and testing this June. So it was a pretty tight time frame. I think we're on it. There are some complications now with the new PFAS regulations, and I'll get into that in a minute. But our design team is Environmental Partners Group. The general contractor is West Construction Corporation. They actually built our Northeastern Village wastewater treatment plant. The vessel and media is being provided by Calgon Carbon Corporation. The design budget was $1.5 million, construction $7.2 million. The vessels themselves cost $1.6 million, or close to $1.7 million, and we have a project contingency of $909,000. The current status, we're about 49% complete. We have available 10.2% contingency, and we have several pending change orders, which I'll get into, and that's what is on the agenda for following this. First is a contract amendment with Environmental Partners. It's amendment number 4 for $48,000 to increase the amount of resident representative services. We anticipated a certain amount of weeks of service, and the construction is just going a little longer. Still within the contract time we anticipated, but required more resident representative services, so we need an increase there. Change order number 1 for $73,000 in change with WES. It's for adding a flow meter at well 1, a new bag filtration system, and that's related to changing the media in one of our wells. I'll talk about that in a second. Some bolt replacements and some float switches with WES. And then with Calgon, we're going to be changing the media. Through the bench scale testing, we were planning on carbon, but during the bench scale testing that we did during the construction, they came in while we're under construction and ran these different medias through just to make sure we're getting the best one. Well 2 has higher level of PFAS and it's got a higher flow rate. So the thought was that we'd have too many changes of carbon. The carbon wouldn't last as long. So there was a recommendation to change to a ion exchange resin, and that's a little more expensive. It'll last longer, but it's more expensive.
So we're gonna go through in well two and go to an ion exchange resin. So that and a credit for the bolt replacement. So the bolt replacement that we're paying West for was related to the Calgon vessels. They shipped the wrong bolts. Calgon is giving us a credit for what we're paying West to change those out. So it's a no cost to the town, but it's included in both of their change orders. So the substantial change order is for $284,000 for Calgon, basically for that ion resin exchange. And again, with PFAS treatment, we designed these under the DEP regulation, and last month, you know, EPA is proposing something new. At this point, we believe that we can stay with the granular activated carbon at well 1 and 4 and go to the ion exchange resin at well 2 and then really monitor the performance in the field of how well 2 does and look at the cost benefit, whether we should change to a resin on the other two as well. And this is really just, it comes down to a cost benefit feature. We're looking at bench scale testing that's given us these answers, but it's a recommendation to put it actually in full scale production and evaluate how well it does. The carbon will just be quicker changes to meet the new EPA regulation. So based on that, we may end up going to a resin, but we don't need the resin at this point. So again, that's why we're having this change order, and the impacts of the new potential regulations will just result in us changing these medias quicker, just more operational cost. And just here's just a shot from the Gary Lane site on well 1. So this is the Gary Lane, end of Gary Lane, where this house is. You really can't see the PFAS treatment plants. There's a small, on the left is a picture of the drying bed. So that's the backwash drying bed, similar to the Red Mill Road drying beds. It's when we backwash the filters, which is dries and evaporates to the ground. And probably the ugliest structure you've ever seen on the right, that is the PFAS treatment building. Luckily, no one can see these from the work road. There are utilitarian structures that house these filters. The scale is, you know,
they're
huge.
How tall is it?
They're 30 feet tall.
Yeah, the filters are 30 feet tall.
Yeah. So, you know, these are pretty ugly buildings. So we didn't do any favors to the architects in the area, but it's really never going to be seen by most people. So unless there's a tour for ribbon cutting, most people will never see these. So it's really just utilitarian. Do we have any questions on the PFAS treatment plants? I know, you know, we're looking forward to these being up and running and us to be in compliance with the Mass DEP regulation. At that point, we can take away the blue drop filter, and we'll be supplying water that's below the state standard to everyone in Easton. And I think it's going to be a huge relief and a weight off of Rich and his staff. We have to send out quarterly notices now, reminding people that we're in non-compliance, and take that and pay a lot of money to have a blue drop filter at the water division. So it'll be good when this is done, and June can't come quick enough. Any comments, Rich? Or?
No, but like you both pointed out about the media, that really is the bane of all this, is to find out how long that material holds up. And, once these facilities go online, the last thing we want to find out is that we have to change out the media within a year. So it's kind of like one of those things where you really want to get this treatment going, but also you need to have some understanding of how long is that media going to last in these vessels. And from an operational perspective, if you're having to change out this media less than 2 years, you really have to go back and look at the other option, which resin may give us a longer longevity in these filters, and that may save the town more money by doing that.
Yeah. Just to give a perspective, the ion exchange resin is 10 times more expensive than
the
CAC. So it's more expensive, but it'll give us a longer life. So it's really a cost benefit. And we'll evaluate that. They are developing new media right now too, there's new media being developed, so hopefully it'll be something that's bigger and better and works better, and hopefully it's cheaper. So we'll know that as we go forward. So if there's no questions, let's move on to water main. I'll go quick on these next few projects. But the indoor water main replacements, we've been lucky we're funding $1.5 million a year now for water main replacements. And the reason is we want to keep our system, our distribution system, in a good state of good repair. As you can see by the graph in the middle here, water main breaks have trended upwards over the last 22 years since we've been keeping track in this format. So it's really needed to, we have pipe that's that was put in 1887. So, and a good majority of our pipe was put in between the 40s and the 80s. So we're coming up on 50 to 75 year lifespan on some of these pipes. So we want to take out some of the underperforming and older pipes in our system and try to do that on a systematic basis. So the current project we have right now is the Foundry Street water main, and that includes Norton Ave, small piece of Norton Ave, small piece of Foundry Street. We're using $1.5 million that's been appropriated over the last 2 years. We're requesting another $1.5 million going forward. And we're replacing that 8-inch older water main that was underperforming. We had a lot of breaks on that area. And we're upgrading it to a 12-inch, which will help in conjunction with the new Red Mill Road treatment plant to give better hydraulic capacity in that area. This was designed and bid in 2022. We anticipated construction to start in the late summer, early fall, but last year, and still to this day, it's tough to get pipe. So water pipe was a commodity. You could not really get it. It had about a 6 months to a year lead time. So our contractor is C. Naughton, and they were able to get the pipe and start the project this winter. Ty and Bond did the design for us, and C. Naughton, who also did the five-quarter sewer and water project, is our contractor. They started in February. It's probably 65% complete money-wise, but they've installed all the main line to date, and now we're just working on services. So we anticipate that the project will be complete in June, and the final paving will have happened by then. And on the water mains, as soon as we're done with that, we're going to start design of our next water main projects. We have a couple of candidates that we're looking at to replace older pipe in Northeastern Village, and we also have Prospect Street. So. Bay Road storage, water storage tank, $1.58 million was appropriated last year. It's for the rehabilitation of this tank. It was built in 1957 and was last cleaned and painted in 2007. Work includes upgrades for electrical equipment, security, a new mixing system, and a new epoxy paint job. That's currently being designed by Environmental Partners, and hopefully we'll be able to bid this late spring or summer. And then a hydraulic model, which was $50,000 was appropriated last year. Ty and Bond is doing the design on this. We're currently in draft format right now, but basically this is a model. You take the entire system, you model it, and then you actually go out and do pressure testing to figure out what your actual conditions are in the field so you can calibrate that model. So we can use this to tell us a lot of features about our distribution system, where we have issues, where we have pressure issues or hydraulic issues, and it will let us know scenarios. If we shut off this pump and run this pump, who gets what water, and we can try to narrow down on some things. So it's a nice tool to have, especially when you're dealing with future water main projects. It might help raise some projects up above others if there's a hydraulic benefit to it. So that's all I have on the water.
That's all.
If you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. Otherwise, we can get into the change orders.
Jen, stop you.
I actually have no questions because this was extremely thorough, and I think you're building upon things we've been hearing about. So thank you for that very thorough summary.
Very thorough.
I'm not saying thorough as being long. I'm sorry. I apologize.
No, no, I will tell you you're too long. No, not at all.
We've had conversations in the past about the Red Mill Road plan in terms of some barrier so that my neighbors will get a little bit more comfortable with that. Have we settled on a plan for that yet, or is that something that's going to happen in the future?
Yeah, there's a plan in place that will go out and put in those plantings, select plantings. So it's on the plan. That won't be until probably the spring of 2024. But there's a chance that we'll get to some of it maybe this fall if the site work is progressed enough. But our main focus is getting that plant up and running, started and tested, so we can provide some cleaner water, take out that iron and manganese. But it's on the plan, and we will get to it.
Thank you.
Jamie, any questions?
No, thank you to both David and Rich. Appreciate it.
So I think it's great. I think it's worth pointing out that we don't see the construction of these when we're driving down the street, or it's not like general party conversation. So much work is going on behind the scenes. This is on top of all the other roadway construction and other big DPW construction projects. So I appreciate the detail. The thoroughness is well appreciated. And also the pictures, because they're not places that I would ever drive by and see. Most people are not going to see those. Like you said, you can't see them from the street or from the neighborhoods. So.
These are gated areas, so most people don't have access. So. We're happy to give tours when these things are ready. But again, these are not most features that most people are going to see all the time. So.
Right. But I appreciate the excellent work that you do and your team in keeping us up to date on it.
So. I just want to add, particularly, Dave, thank you always. But Rich, Rich joined our team basically as the entire drinking water industry was getting turned upside down by these regulatory changes. And you know, we knew that that was coming to an extent, and when we were interviewing folks, we were really looking for people with experience with mature, large systems who had managed treatment plants. These had not for our entire history, because up until this very new moment in regulatory time that we're in, our water was not only compliant, it was award-winning. And for Rich had to hit the ground running, and for 3 years, including COVID, I mean, managing close to $30 million in these capital projects has been no small feat. Dottie, to your point, a lot of it out of the public view, just kind of quietly working. Thank you, Rich. Great work.
Thank you.
All right, so we want to vote on these amendments. If you want to make a motion, it's item 10, throw 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah, if you would like, you could do a slate. We grouped it this way just so you know it wasn't 7 pages long.
So the slate is $406,177.79, and that's going to come out of the available project contingency of about
$910,000.
$910,000.
Okay. So
moved,
Roger.
Second, Lynn.
Roger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Liam, yes.
Bulgy, that a yes.
Barbie, yes.
Vince, yes.
Thank you. So the next one is discussion and vote also on DPW 2023-11 change order number 1 with Phoenix Communications for fiber optic cable relocation on Depot Street.
Yes, thank you. This is a change order to an existing contract. We're adding $25,360 to Phoenix Communications' other contract, which is under ITC 68 state bid, and we're paying for this through the $129,000 Community Compact Municipal Fiber Grant. And this was related to some pole relocations and extending and splicing fiber optics that were existing on those poles and to move and be spliced. So that's the reason for this. The work has already happened. We didn't anticipate quite the extent of the cost. So that's why we've come back to add a change order in to make that happen.
Okay. Any questions? No questions?
Move to approve change order number 1 for contract DPW 2023-11 in the amount of $25,360 paid to Phoenix Communications.
Second, Lamb.
Barger and Lamb.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Great. All right, item 12, change order for the town office's rehabilitation project.
Thanks, Rich. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Rich.
Thank you, Rich.
Thank you.
You all.
Deputy Director Swan, we'll take a point on this one.
Good evening. Before you is change orders 4 and 5 for the exterior repairs to town hall. Change order 4, the first portion is for rehabilitation of the wellhead cover for the well located on the grounds. It's corroded, it's failing, it needs to be saved. This restoration feature will cost about $13,230, and it'll now be safe to put back on the wellhead. Second item under change order four is during the course of construction, while we're replacing gutters, we found 20 roof slates that needed to be replaced. It was the fact that we knew that that was going to happen. We had a cost on the contract. We exceeded our initial amount. So at a cost of $150 per slate, we replaced 20 slates, so for a cost of $3,000. Change order five is for after we repaired, we abated all the windows, removed all the lead and all the asbestos, we brought all the windows and we installed them. There were some damages and scratches that occurred before the project began. We didn't know if we'd be able to afford replacement at that time, so we waited to the end of the project. By doing so, now that the windows have been abated and decontaminated, the contractor can come and replace those glass panes on site at a substantial savings to the town. If we had done that as part of the original contract, it would have cost us in the neighborhood of $20,000. But now, because the windows have been abated and they can do everything on site, the contractor gave us a price of $3,000 to fix all of the scratch glass. So we will have fix all of the notoriously cleaned, very well cleaned glass panes as part of this project.
Was
$3,000 or $3,800? But still, it's a substantial cost savings to the town. So those two will bring these two amendments will bring the total cost of the $20,030, bringing the project almost to completion. We'll still have $16,000 left in contingency, but we're here. I know this project has been going on for a little over a year. We had a slowdown for the winter. Storm doors and storm windows will be delivered on Thursday. We'll start those installations after a mock-up on Friday. So once again, we will see some activity around here. We'll be wrapping up. When this is done, we'll do before and after pictures to show everybody that you might not remember what it looked like, even though it was last year, but we have it memorialized. But we're getting close.
And then Public Works is doing some in-house work as well.
Correct, in conjunction with this.
And yep. Some interior work.
Yeah, so we've redone the foyer again. As some of you may notice, we're working on the front doors for ADA access at this point. We have to redo the front circle to bring everything into ADA compliance. Before we can do that, we need to repair the septic system. That's been an ongoing issue. We finally had a chance to do that. And now we have a chance to update some of the plumbing in addition to it. So it's really given the town hall a facelift to make everything work like it should.
So what are the features of the ADA compliance in the front entry and in the roadway?
So the front entrance is the big one, is the concrete slab leading up to the doors. It has a 5% pitch on it. You don't notice it being so steep because of how short it is, but there's a step up. Okay, so there's a step up and there's a ramp to it. So we're going to take out the front concrete slab, pour it level, and then we're going to bring the driveway up to meet it to ADA grade. So everything will be a seamless transition when we're all said and done. So it'll be noticeable when you see it. But that'll be done. It's one of the dominoes we're hoping to fall this summer.
Any other comments, questions? Jamie, anything from you?
No, thank you.
All right.
So
great.
Well, I move to approve PBW 2022-25 change orders 4 and 5 to an amount of $20,030.
Second, Lamb.
Barger and Lamb.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Fulgenetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Evans, yes.
Evans, yes.
Excellent. All right, that it for you?
Yeah, I hope so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
for being here.
All right.
Item 14, vote to authorize the department to execute the aggregate community choice supply price contract for a term of up to 3 years.
Thank you, Dottie. So I'm actually double checking now. I'm not certain. Did the pricing information made it into your packet? It did.
Should be.
Should be, okay. Well, if not, we asked based on
the meeting with Colonial Power at your last meeting, where they just gave kind of an update on the performance of our energy aggregation plan, getting ready to have the town position to go to market again and execute another 3-year agreement. Our current 3-year fixed rate is from November of 2020. It ends in November of 2023. Timing of that ended up being really, really, really fortuitous for us and has saved millions for the community compared to market rates here at Engrid. So based on some examples of indicative pricing that we've seen from Colonial Power for some of their other clients, depending on the amount of years you go and depending on the supplier on a given day, we are seeing prices closer to 14, 15, 16, 17 cents per kilowatt hour, which is still substantially better than the winter rate we're seeing now. It's not substantially above the current proposed summer rate for grid, which I think is 14 and change. But what we wanted to do was have a board authorize me within some parameters on those prices. What we're suggesting is for a term up to 3 years, and to execute an agreement on the board's behalf for a successor contract to start this November, not to exceed 15 cents per kilowatt hour. So that's only marginally above the summer rate that we think is coming. We can't predict the future, but winter rates this winter were over 30 cents per kilowatt hour. So we're hoping we can do a little better than that, but it's going to depend on the prices that day. So they're anticipating around Wednesday. If there was not a combination of duration and rate that fit under that, then I wouldn't move forward, and I would just notify you and we could figure out a plan from there.
Do you think you need more room than 15 cents? I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to moving it up to 16 or 17%. I'd hate for you to have to come back and be like, yeah, it was 15.5, or something like that, and we didn't give you enough negotiating.
I'm happy for the board to do so. This was the ballpark that Colonial suggested. I would still, even if you said 16 or 17, I'm going to try and get it as low as possible, because even if we were doing better than the market, folks here have been used to 10 cents for 3 years now. So it's going to be noticeable. So we want to minimize that to the extent we can. Without being short-sighted and going for a 6-month contract or something like that.
Right.
So,
I just feel like you kind of have to, it's a judgment call on that day based on the research and the data, and as long as you have enough room, you think that that's enough and that's what the consultants are saying, then that's fine, but just wanted to double check that. Any questions, comments? Jamie?
No, thank you.
I move to authorize the town administrator to procure to supply for Easton's aggregate community choice supply price contract for a term of up to 3 years and to execute any agreements on the town's behalf related thereto for prices not to exceed 15 cents per kilowatt hour for basic service.
Second, Lynn.
Roger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Evans, yes.
All right, perfect. Good luck, Father. Item 14, Town Administrator Update, Municipal Facilities Replacement, Police Fire DPW Feasibility Planning.
I don't have any major updates today. We're still working on more survey and wetland work. We're negotiating with Stonehill on that component and associated kind of real estate related projects. We do have flagging and survey work now ongoing at Center School as well. So those things are all moving forward. We are still tracking for May for schematic design phase budgeting with the Municipal Building Committee. I should have more information at the next meeting in April.
Next is a review, May 15th, 2023, annual town meeting warrant draft.
Sure. Attached to your packet is the most current version of the annual town meeting warrant. There are only two articles before you tonight. I believe the remainder of articles will be financial related, which we will deal with a hopefully balanced budget at your next meeting, April 24th, and a capital plan that Director Nightingale and I are going to the Capital Committee to review tomorrow night. and planning articles at your first meeting in May. So these are kind of the last low-hanging articles, so to speak. So the first one is Article 10 that we're recommending an inclusion and a recommendation on, which would rescind $30,000 of borrowing authorized in 2019 for the turf and track replacement at Moscato Stadium that's no longer needed because the project was completed, that amount was not spent. So this will just take it off the books.
I move to include and recommend Article 10.
Second, Lamb.
Bodger and Lamb.
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
RG, yes.
Stevens, yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Article 11 is to appropriate, as the board may recall, you saw a mid-year free cash certification update. The town, through Assistant Town Administrator Blanchard, has been managing a variety of claims as part of the Massachusetts Opioid Litigation Association's class actions against various pharmaceutical manufacturers and distributors, including a new broader package that the board just signed off on recently. Settlement agreements have been negotiated at the state level, and the towns of the Commonwealth need to appropriate those funds out for specific types of uses related to drug intervention and recovery as a financial damage paid by these companies to the communities that they've harmed through the opioid epidemic. This is just an appropriation article. We need to do this in order to put it in a segregated fund, which is a part of the settlement agreement. If you don't appropriate it, it ends up just closing to free cash. It becomes harder to track. We don't want that. We are currently working internally to go through the settlement agreements and cross-check that to the current services we're providing through the town and the school department that line up with eligible expenses, and are looking towards the state as far as what they've done with their opioid task force, as far as once we've established what are the things we're already doing that fit within these parameters for funding, what's the capacity for any kind of potential additional programming. So Michael's done a lot of work on this. You want to just kind of weigh in and give a little bit more context to where we think this is heading? And
yeah, I mean, I think you really hit most of it. You know, the agreements provide a broad list of abatement strategies the town can employ, many of which we already do. And I think Connor, you know, mentioned, you know, it's no surprise to anyone we have a revenue issue. And so our first priority would be to determine what we're doing and make sure we can continue to do those very successful programs and then start to look at what else we could offer without overcommitting ourselves and not having enough funds to do that. So it'll be a good process. We'll include the public. But as Carl mentioned, this is simply just an accounting exercise. This is not committing the money in any particular direction.
Okay. Any comments, questions?
Just thank you, Mike, for all the hard work you were doing this. I know it's been a lot of work and it's been, so thank you.
Absolutely. Likewise.
I move to include and recommend Article 11.
Second, Lynn.
Audra, is that?
Stacy, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Bolton, yes. Audra, yes.
Evans, yes.
Yes.
All
right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Only the two articles for now. So there's the operating and capital budget should be your next meeting. We'll try to get an update as well on the solar lease article. And then we believe the planning department is on track for coming in on May 1st. And that should be everything, but we will definitely go back and make sure we're listening.
So we have an executive session, or wait a second. We get the acceptance of.
Item 16.
Item 16. So, sorry, I'm just losing my track here. So, are we going to have an executive session for this afterwards, Connor?
Yes, so 16 is open session, it's just for performance review.
Right. All right, so let me just get my notes on my computer here. So, every year, before we go into the town election season, well, we have the board, or I should start it off like this. After the election season, the people that are seated on this board work with the town administrator to establish goals and objectives for the following year. So before the next election cycle starts again, the people that made those goals and objectives measure that performance. So we didn't have any changeover in the board last year, but I just wanted people to know why it happens in that time frame. So each of the select board members took the goals and objectives from last year, sent it to me, and I compiled them all into a list. And I'll bring that up. Let's everything run slow. Okay, so I'm just gonna run through and talk about some of the highlights and just kind of tell you it was a very good, exceptional, in fact, performance review. We evaluated Connor on 11 categories. The first one was finance. And the way it works is the town administrator does a self-evaluation and he gives commentary and whether he meets, exceeds, or does not meet the requirements. So for finance, I'm gonna tell you the categories and then how everybody weighed in. So for finance, Reed said meets expectations. Fulginetti said exceeds, Barger said exceeds, Lamb said meets, Stebbins says exceeds, and Stacy says exceeds. For infrastructure, facilities, and public works, Reed says exceeds, Fulginetti, Barger, Lamb, Stebbins, and Stacy all agreed and said exceeds. For climate and energy policy, Reed says meets. The full board also said meets in that condition. Planning and economic development, Reed said meets. The full board agreed meets. Public health, safety, and community wellness, Reed said meets. The full board said exceeds. Quality of life, community engagement, and inclusivity, Reed said exceeds, and the board concurred, all said exceeds. Human resource management, labor relations, and organizational stability, Reed said exceeds. The full board agreed exceeds. Town government efficiency, effectiveness, and resiliency, Reed said meets. Fulginetti said meets, Barger said exceeds, Lamb said exceeds, Stebbins and Stacy both said meets. Service and support to the select board, Reed said meets, Fulginetti and Barger said exceeds, Lamb said meets, and Stebbins and Stacy also said exceeds. Inter and intra-governmental relationships, Reed said meets, Fulginetti, Lamb, Stebbins and Stacy said exceeds, Barger said meets. Personal and professional growth, Reed said exceeds, and the board agreed, each member said exceeds. So it's a pretty comprehensive evaluation. Each one of those sections has a narrative with it, and it will go on the town's website. But I do want to open it up to the board to see if anybody had anything that stuck out for them or a general overall comment on the evaluation. So I can start with you, Jen.
As always, it's really, really difficult to find things that Connor doesn't do well. So, you know, you try to look with the lens of finding those things and understanding where the opportunities. I think there are some spaces where we have room for you to grow in your leadership capacity, but for the most part, you're doing a phenomenal job, and you've been a pleasure to work with. So.
Mark?
Yeah, much in the same. Connor, I think you are your biggest critic. Nobody can be harder on you than you are on yourself, and by virtue of that, you keep the bar very, very high, and you continue to hit it. And what that does is it sets examples for all your department heads. And look around at the department heads, and they're outstanding. They set the bar high because you lead by example. So thank you, and please continue.
Thank you. Right. I have absolutely enjoyed working with you for the last 6 years. I concur with my colleagues that you are tougher on yourself than you should be. I think that you're incredibly thoughtful, you're creative, you've got a great way of working with people. And I've said this every year since 2017. I was the third vote to hire you in 2017, and I have never, ever regretted that decision in 6 years.
I was wondering if you're going to say that. That's
just going to replace the entire 22-page document next year. Make sure Craig says it each year.
So your success is his credit.
It's a team. I don't think it goes.
It's a joke.
It's not really. I mean, that was not easy for two that are here and one that's not.
Very difficult.
It was a difficult meeting and process, and so it's appreciated.
Jamie?
Hey, the hallmark of a great leader is one that never stops learning and continuing to ask questions of themselves and being well-read. And you continue to do just that, to continue to learn and bring, add value, not just to the position, but to the community. And it's your personal growth, right? The things that you provide as a leader, and your desire to grow as a person and giving back, not just, and I wrote this pretty explicitly in my feedback, was that you're giving back not just to the town of Easton, you're giving back to greater society. So keep up the good work.
Very much. Thank you, Jamie.
So I agree with what everyone said, and just to like pull out a few highlights, one of the things that really struck to me is that we talk a lot about succession planning, and you know, we run a very lean organization, and we have to really be thinking you know, about how do things look now, but how do things look, you know, when people are retiring or positions are changing and down the road, what do we do to protect the organization, so to speak, of town services? And you know, a lot of times we have to zig and zag around some of these things that come up, and if you don't have a lot of forward thought on succession planning, you can really run into a lot of trouble. And I know that Connor has that as an underpinning of all of these categories with all the departments. For finance, our finances are strong. We've got an exceptional bond rating again once again this year. Our stabilization fund is healthy. We've gotten about $500,000 in new grants this year outside of ARPA, the MSBA reimbursement, SEMREC grants, ESSER, etc. So that's a real testimony for, you know, how our departments work. We've got the GFOA Distinguished Budget Award. I think, you know, the expectation is that we're so used to getting the top bar all the time. It's almost a little unfair because you have set the bar high, but we have very high expectations because we usually meet or exceed what these goals are. And it just sounds kind of like, oh yeah, he's exceptional again. But I think that we really need to think about that a little bit. It's a lot of work to ask for one person, but your team, the whole department of four, to accomplish this is really amazing. The infrastructure, facilities, and public works, you know, we've just had ongoing construction all the time, whether it's roads or like we saw tonight with the water treatment facility. It just happens. We know it's happening. They come in, the work is done correctly. It's usually on time. It's usually on or at budget. The climate and energy, you know, even though we have goals and objectives throughout the year, you're kind of adding things to that. So looking at maybe in the future doing an energy policy and, you know, always thinking ahead to those next steps.
I do just want to flag on that if I could, Donnie, because Jen, you flagged that as well in your written comments, and I assume in your ones tonight. We are working on becoming more comprehensive there. We do have funding requests outstanding in the capital budget, just given the level of need that's probably not getting funded this spring, but we have filed through the state One Stop for Growth process for master plan funding to consolidate and synthesize the, I think a substantial amount of efforts we are making, but have been being coordinated on an ad hoc basis to make sure that we're continuing to push in that area.
Fantastic.
Excellent. And that wasn't something that we talked about prior, so that's something that you're bringing forward now. The planning and economic development, there's been a lot of work with that. You know, there's some things that we can't control, some things we're trying to control. We have, you know, I think that that's something that has, you know, always it's evolving, and you have to wait for the right time. You have to know when to strike when the iron's hot, and a lot of that's outside of our control, but trying to set up the environment where we can have good economic development, you know, it's a work in progress, so I think that we're always going to be looking at that. Public health, safety, and community wellness has been amazingly transformed over the past couple of years, and we have more mental health facility support. The paramedicine is really going well, so these are really transformational changes within that department. Quality of life, community engagement, and inclusivity. The town administrator is supporting a lot of community-based efforts and programs. You know, everything that we do, you also have to remember a lot of it's administrative work related, and then thinking about how does that affect the well-being of the community, making sure to include that. Human resources management, Connor negotiated all the union contracts and, you know, does that in a way that builds trusted relationships with the unions, works under the guidelines that the board sets forward, and doing that with a level of appreciation to the people that work for the town is a really delicate balance. And I think that that's something, when we did hire you, that we were concerned about and thinking about, you know, how is that going to work? And you beat the expectations on that every year, so congratulations on that one. Let me see, the town government efficiency, effectiveness, and resiliency. Resiliency is something that really could be used in every single one of these categories, but advancing cybersecurity is a really important issue. You know, it has been, it's been hard to get it up to the plate because we've had budget constraints, so getting grants to make some of these things happen is really great.
We've built a lot of capacity. We have a lot of things coming down the pipe there that you'll start seeing soon. Just the interim stakeholder meetings for that project have more people than our department head meetings. It's eye-opening.
And, you know, the police department receiving their reaccreditation code of conduct for elected and appointed officials are a couple of highlights there. Service and support to the select board. I think you're available to, I think everybody noted that you're available to each of us independently when we have questions. I think that that's really important, that every member of this board feels that they're an important member and that they have access to ask you questions and get timely responses and thorough responses anytime they need it. Intra-governmental relationships, you know, as who mentioned it, I think Jamie was the one who said that, you know, working with this board is great, working with this town is great, but you also work across other boundaries and regions and the state as well, very well recognized. And professional with all of this work and, you know, a family and a life and hobbies outside of this, it's really hard to balance all that, and I think you're doing a really good job with that as well. So did you have anything that you wanted to highlight or comment, or?
Just to say thank you, and you know, we had some of it tonight with Public Works in particular is always a really kind of obvious example because of the very concrete, you know, pun intended, nature of what they're doing, but we have really exceptional people here. I've been here long enough, I've been doing this long enough now, but I have been able to really enjoy seeing the leadership team grow and change with a lot of folks that we've been able to hire, and I'm very proud of the work that they do, and the staff as well. You mentioned collective bargaining. This was probably one of the most challenging environments for labor management negotiations in decades, and we were able to collaboratively, without mediation with any unions, reach reasonable agreements to do right by our workforce, but try to balance the long-term finances of the town, which is incredibly hard because of the structural revenue deficit that we're very aware of. So to be able to do that, you know, top out our stabilization funds as we sunset COVID relief dollars, it's been great. I'm very, very lucky to have Michael, Elizabeth, and Mary in my office, and I'm fortunate to work with you as a board. So thank you. And the community has been great as well. Remarkably patient with all the road work and construction, and it's been a good run, and I'd like to keep that going. So.
Excellent. All right. Well, would you like to make a motion to accept the town administrator's evaluation as noted in the packet?
With pleasure.
Barger. Second, Lynn.
Barger and Lynn.
Stacy, yes.
Lynn, yes.
Fulginetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
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 Excellent. And this will be posted on the town website. I hope that people that are watching this meeting, I encourage them to read the evaluation. I think you'd be really surprised by the level of detail of all the work that's happening. That's one of the things that, you know, most people, before they get to know town government or in the Citizens Academy, people are generally very surprised at the amount of work that happens through Connor's office and as a result of all the departments that we have. So take a look at that and see the comments. It's worth a read. So for executive session, I just want to make sure that I have the, should we do the other items first and then go into executive session for vote and then come back to open session?
Well, you have to come back anyway, so it's your call. It's whatever your preference is on the items.
Let's just take off 18 through 21 so that I don't forget them when we come back. And then we'll make a motion to go into executive session to come back into open. Okay. Does that work?
Oh, yeah.
Sure. All right. So item 18 is the acceptance of March 27th minutes.
Move to approve.
Second, Lamb.
Audrey and Lamb.
Stacey, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barge, yes.
Stephens, yes.
Stephens, yes.
Approval only of executive session minutes to March 13th, 2023.
So moved, Bob.
Second, Lamb.
That's Barge and Lamb.
Stacey, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barge, yes.
Stephens, yes.
Town administrator notes.
I do not have any to add.
Assistant town administrator, anything?
No, sir.
Okay. Select board notes? None here either. All right. I will take a motion and a second and a roll call vote to go into executive session under purposes 2 and 3 of Mass General Law 38, Section 21A, respectively to discuss strategy with respect to non-union personnel or contract negotiations with non-union personnel, Connor Reed, and to discuss litigation relating to Great Builders. If the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the public body. So we will vote to enter into executive session to return back to open session.
So moved, Barger.
Second, Lamb.
Barger and Lamb.
Stacey, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Stebbins, yes.
Hey, excellent.
We have the meeting before you move back, 4 p.m. All right, so we are back, and So we are back, and after our executive session, I just want to congratulate you, Connor. We have voted to extend your contract to June 30th, 2027, which, as you noted, will be your 10th year as town administrator. So that's coming up really fast. So we unanimously voted on that, and also some other contract language that will be posted online with your contract. Is that how I would say that? Getting tired? Yes, it was an amendment and an extension through June of 27, so thank you.
All right, so are you going to take another public
yes,
vote
yeah,
right now?
Open session.
So, Craig?
Oh, Barger, yes.
I'll make
a motion to accept the contract through 2027.
The amended contract.
Amended contract.
Second, Lamb.
So that's Barger and Lamb. Roll call vote.
Stacey, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Barger, yes.
Evans, yes.
And did anybody have any comments they wanted to share with Connor before we sign off?
Glad to have you for another year.
Thank you.
Really, we're very lucky to have you in this community. Thank you for all the hard work you've put into making this place better, and look forward to continue working with you.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Mark?
Same.
Frank?
I'm not going to say it again, but I congratulations and thank you for the work that you do on behalf of this board and this town.
Jamie?
Yeah, I look forward to working and continue to work with you, Connor, so.
Thanks, Jamie.
And it was an excellent review, excellent evaluation, and we're glad that you will stay with us through the end of 2027. So, congratulations, and with that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
You didn't vote. You didn't say Full Genetti yes.
You sure?
Positive.
Full Genetti yes?
There you go.
Thank you, good catch.
Yeah, well, this was an important one.
Thank you, Mark.
You know what, it's confusing doing the roll call because everybody's not in the same places. It's easier when it's all on Zoom or it's on here, so thank you.
I thought she did. I need to go back and watch the video.
It's better to say yes twice.
It is.
Absolutely. Play.
Yeah.
But in any event, it was a unanimous vote. So with that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So move, Bodger.
Second, Lamb.
Bodger and Lamb.
Stacey, yes.
Lamb, yes.
Full Genetti, yes.
Bodger, yes.
Simmons, yes.
All right, great. Thanks for being here, Jamie. We appreciate you.
Nice to see you, Jamie.
Making the effort to get here by Zoom.
Thanks. Have a good night. See you guys.
Bye, Jamie.
Thank you, ECAT. You can sign off.
Just need to sign the cards.